As part of our ongoing EduLeaders Speak series, we've been discussing some important issues in the field of education. And today we have with us Dr. Deepak Madhok. To introduce him in brief, he is the chairman of the Varanasi-based Sunbeam Group of Educational Institutions. He's been instrumental in providing quality K-12 education in some of the most underprivileged regions in Uttar Pradesh. Dr. Madhok was also the former civic administrator at the Uttar Pradesh Public Service Commission and has been an alumnus of the Banaras Hindu and Allahabad Universities. Welcome, Dr. Madhok.
Thank you so much, Reshma. A pleasure to be with the Education World.
Thank you so much, sir. So, you know, we begin our discussion by asking one very important question, and it is about where you would place education on your national list of priorities. And do you think that the education outlay must be doubled by cutting defense expenditure?
See, the education is the answer to everything. The fact remains, when we look at the pandemic, you look at it at the point of view for the entire human race. COVID-19 can be followed by COVID-25. So what is the challenge which we have, or what is the answer to that challenge we have? Education. Mm-hmm. To everything, somebody has said education is the chief defense of a nation. And we don't need tanks and guns, we need education everywhere. And if you want to spoil something for a country, spoil its education system.
You come from Uttar Pradesh. Basically, Uttar Pradesh has a good number of budget schools. So, you know, because of COVID, you know, schools were, you know, mandated to shift online. So what were some of the challenges that you faced in terms of internet connectivity or availability of gadgets and technology, etc.?
See, overnight, everyone had to change to the upgrade their technologies. They have to work on their mobile phones, borrow phones from their parents, take somebody's laptop, and everybody had to hurry. This was something which just happened suddenly. And we all had to adapt. We had to swim or sink. And for that, in Uttar Pradesh, for the budget schools, it was not easy at all. Many of the schools did not have internet connections, or some of the schools in very far-flung districts did not have a 5G or 3G connections at all. So it was very difficult. And then the technology of the various platforms had also not developed. Some of the Zoom platforms and the other platforms which we see today, they have changed a lot in the last 2 years. Even Google has changed a lot. So everybody upgraded, including the teachers of the budget school and the students. Initially, they started sending WhatsApp messages. They started recording. And some of them even went on radio.
What were some of the most common concerns that you heard from them? And what were the issues that needed to be addressed?
Initially, the parents were not at all convinced about online education. They thought it's a gadget, it's a game. So everybody said, oh, this is not going to help. And then they always had hopes that the schools will open in 2-3 months. So it was just like an extended summer vacation. And I remember 2020 summer, when everybody was at home and it was counting the days. They said 30 days gone. Now the schools are going to open. The business is going to be back. It was as if it's just a very temporary phase. But this carried on and on. And because of this, the parents also, they kept on sitting in front of the cameras when the teachers were teaching. And many of the parents, the fathers and mothers who were staying at home, they could see their children studying on a small mobile phone. And then they realized that this little screen is the only way to knowledge. Okay. So slowly the belief started building up.
Okay. Now, you know, as a small little ray of hope, we see schools being reopened in a phased manner in some parts of the country. So what is your take on reopening in-person classes in full strength?
Yeah, I think the government is also seized of the matter. In fact, all the school associations have been now talking to the governments. In fact, FICCI has done a good job, and the local associations have also started They did start talk to the government a long time back, about 1.5 years ago, impressing upon them the widening learning gap about how a child from age, because this is there in the national education policy as well, that from age 5 to age 10 is the most important phase when the brain expands exponentially to almost about maybe 5 times of 4 times. And if a child in these last 4 years who hasn't been to school, you know, imagine a boy or a girl who has not been to school and is and was 4 years old when the COVID struck. So what's going to happen to them? You know, they have fears. I have seen children who are 6 years old or 7 years old. They are scared to meet people and they don't have. You say peer-to-peer education is the most important thing. The touch, the feel of a book, with the going into a classroom, the holding of a teacher's hand. So, so many small things which have shaped our destiny, our lives, our knowledge. So that was not there. So we tried our best to impress upon the government, whatever done, try to open the schools as much as possible.
Okay.
And that yielded results. That did yield results.
When we're talking about a minimal peer-to-peer interaction, when we are talking about minimal teacher-student interactions, you know, one important issue that is also being spoken about is learning loss among children. So, you know, once we start in-person classes or physical classes for students, how do you think this needs to be addressed?
I think that coming back to class and the CBSE and the other boards have reduced a lot of syllabi. Mm-hmm. And the best thing is for the children is to go to school and go to their classroom, their teachers, their friends, and crash course their way as much as possible. Because we also know the attention span of a child is very, very small. You can't just overload. Knowledge is such a thing. It comes slowly. So this is a difficult thing to do. I realize, we all realize, all educators know that. But nevertheless, we cannot stop trying. We have to somehow bridge the learning loss in physical schools.
Once the pandemic recedes, do you recommend that classes should go back to where it was completely offline, or do you think there should be blended learning?
We in our schools, in all our 10 branches or all our associate schools all over Uttar Pradesh, maybe 30 of them, and what have we thought about it? We were thinking, we were planning of having at least 1 or 2 days online classes per week.
Okay.
So the child stays at home and happy in his own home, on his computer. You already have, many of them have bought the hardware. So we will use that hardware in imparting blended education in which they stay at home. Sometimes when even there is a holiday, you can have a half a day's classes or maybe two periods of Zoom, in which you can even do Zumba classes.
Who's the thinker or philosopher you admire the most?
As a philosopher, as a thinker, as a scientist, Albert Einstein.
Who's your favorite Nobel laureate?
My favorite Nobel laureate would be Madame Marie Curie. She was the one who did not care for her life. And in those days, in the 1910s or 20s, women scientists were very rare. So people almost scoffed her and did not take her seriously, but she fought on. And that is one Nobel laureate I always remember and revere.
Describe your leadership style in one phrase. What would that be?
My leadership is the veranda, balcony, / roaming around, playground. So I leave the offices to my admins. And what I do, I just go around, meet the watchman, go and talk to the bus drivers. I just go to the teachers. I just suddenly walk inside the classroom, look at the smiles, the body language. You know, the body language and the one-to-one interaction with anyone, that is the crux of every management. The temperature of the school can be gauged if you walk down the staircase, see how the children are running, or go to the staff rooms straight away and talk to the teachers, sit down and share the tiffin with them. So I'm a kind of a veranda administrator or a balcony administrator.
What would be your favorite book on education?
21 Solutions for the 21st Century.
It was a very interesting discussion that we had today, and I'd like to thank you for joining us for the meeting.
Thank you so much, Reshma. It was a pleasure, and it's always a pleasure talking to you. And I must thank the leadership of Education World for being there on the top always and for getting everyone together. And that's what you do when you give your awards, and that's what you do when you have your conferences.